Speakers, Jonas Thue Treebak, he's an associate professor at the Center for Metabolic Research here at the University of Copenhagen. And he's actually one of the only people that are doing clinical trials with NAD precursors. So it's really tremendously exciting to have him here today. I'm just going to start your presentation. And let's welcome Jonas to the stage and look forward to your talk.
Thank you, Morten, and thank you to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present some of the studies that we've done over the years. Today I will focus on the role of NAMT and NAD for skeletal muscle integrity and function, so the projects that we have relating to muscle NAD. So it's common sense that to maintain NAD levels in the cell, it's a balance between NAD consuming and NAD producing processes. With aging and pathological conditions, this balance can shift so that the consuming processes consume more NAD than the producing process can produce. This leads to low NAD levels. And with stimulation of NAD biosynthesis, for instance, by NAD precursor supplementation or by inhibiting some of the consuming enzymes, we may be able to shift back this balance and increase NAD levels in the cell, which we believe is metabolically beneficial. So the overall aim in my lab is to define mechanisms linking NAD to metabolic health. We usually use the mouse as the primary model organism. We have projects relating to the brain, the liver, the gut, and also the muscle, and this is what we'll be talking about today. When we can, as Morten also alluded to, we do do clinical trials in humans together with Professor Niels Jessen from Aarhus University Hospital and Steno Diabetes Center in Aarhus. I won't talk about those clinical trials today, though, but translating our findings from animals and cell models into humans is something that we appreciate very much. So NAD is continuously oxidized and reduced in order to generate ATP in the mitochondria, for instance. But it's also a substrate for enzymatic reactions that break down NAD to nicotinamide, here exemplified by the sirtuins. NAD is involved in more than 400 different biochemical reactions in the cell. It's located in different cell organelles, as well as the cytosol. And the half-life, depending on the cell type and the cell organelle, ranges from minutes to hours. And this is why we think that the NAD-generating pathways are particularly important to maintain NAD levels in the cell. NAD can be generated from nicotinamides through the salvage pathway controlled by NAMT. It can be generated from nicotinamide ribosides controlled by nicotinamide riboside kinases. And it can be generated from nicotinic acid through the Price-Handler pathway. These three precursors, so nicotinic acid, nicotinamide riboside, and nicotinamide, are the what we refer to as the B3 vitamins. It can also be generated de novo from tryptophan that merges with the Price-Handler pathway. So these enzymatic reactions that I've highlighted here, these enzymes, they break down NAD, and they all break down NAD to nicotinamide. And because nicotinamide inhibits the activity of these enzymes, we think that NAMT plays an important role in order to relieve this potential inhibition of those important enzymatic reactions. So with age, we have changes in muscle function and metabolism. And we believe that the ability to maintain NAD in the cell is crucial to maintain function and metabolism. So to test this in a human model, if you will, we teamed up with Joseph Homart from East Carolina University, and we did a study in which we took 53 people, and we studied the different enzymes in the NAD-generating pathways. And what we observed was that with age, NAMT in muscle was the only enzyme that actually changed. It decreased, so there's significant negative correlation with between NAMPT in muscle and age, and also with BMI. So we are all getting older. We are also, some of us, getting a little bit heavier with age. So we wanted to know whether you know, we could sort of rejuvenate our NAMPT levels in muscle. So we did an exercise training intervention. We did both aerobic and resistance exercise training in both young and older participants. And you can see that exercise training, independent of mode and also independent of age, increased NAMPT levels in muscle. And I want to highlight that the NAMPT levels in the older participants actually almost reached the untrained young participants. So exercise training is a potent stimulus to, in order to maintain the ability to generate NAD through this pathway. So to be a little bit more mechanistic in our approach, we generated muscle-specific NAMPT knockout mice. I want to highlight the work from, this is work from Astrid and Emilia in my lab. And we had the hypothesis that NAMPT in muscle was crucial for maintaining NAD levels. I should mention that since muscle, skeletal muscle, do not express NAD synthase, which is necessary for the prize handler pathway, it can only generate NAD from nicotinamide, riboside, and nicotinamide. So what we found was the model worked. We have a reduction in NAMPT protein levels in the muscle, but also an astonishing 91% reduction of NAD and NADH in the cell or in the muscle of these mice. These mice are smaller over the time course that we studied them, and they die prematurely. So at starting from 4 weeks of age, they start to die, and at 12 weeks of age, we have only around 35% of the mice left. These mice, they have, the muscles are energetically stressed, indicated here by, we measured ATP levels. At 4 weeks of age, you have a huge reduction in ATP, which rebounds a little bit at 6 and 8 weeks of age. We can also see here, this is the AMP dependent kinase. Increased activity or increased phosphorylation of this kinase at 6 and 8 weeks of age, reflecting this low energy state. So we wanted to know whether mitochondrial function was perturbed in these animals. So we teamed up with Steen Larsen from Center for Healthy Aging here at University of Copenhagen to study the single fibers in the Ouroboros instrument to assess oxidative capacity, and we could see that coupled respiration was hugely decreased in the knockout mice. Interestingly, we also measured CS activity, so citrate synthase activity, and this was not changed. So we collaborated with Joachim Nielsen from University of Southern Denmark to study the ultrastructure of the mitochondria of these mice. And interestingly enough, we found no evidence for changes in mitochondrial morphology in the knockout mice. So total mitochondrial volume is not different. The intermyofibrillar mitochondria content is not different. The subsarcolemmal mitochondrial volume is not different. And even the surface area of the cristae were not different. So they maintain the ability to build mitochondria, even though NAD levels are so low. It's the intrinsic activity of the mitochondrial respiratory chain that is affected here. We studied these mice histologically in more detail, and we were very not surprised, but we saw that they had a large increase in centralized located nuclei in the fibers from 6 and 8 weeks of age. This was also, we could also see increased cells that are expressing this important transcription factor for muscle differentiation. And having these centralized nuclei is indicative of a muscle cell that has recently regenerated. So the muscle is trying to regenerate. So what about muscle stem cells? Do we deplete muscle stem cells during this regeneration? Muscle stem cells have different steps where they have a self-renewal, they proliferate, and they also differentiate and fuse to the existing myofibers. But we measured the amount of satellite cells in the muscle and found no evidence for any differences in the total amount of satellite cells. So it seems like the satellite cells are able to proliferate and maintain the same level as the same number as in the wild type mice. So these the mice, they have another histological feature that is quite prominent, is that from, again, 6 weeks of age, they have a very low fiber area compared to the wild-type mice. You can see the wild-type mice, they double the fiber area from 2 to 4 weeks of age, double again from 4 to 6 weeks of age, and then they increase a little bit more. But the knockout mice were not able to increase fiber area in between these two time points in the time course. They also have this kyphosis of the spinal cord, which is a feature that you also see in aged animals. We did fiber size distribution at the different time points, and just these are quite busy, but you can just look at these. You can see that there are many more fibers in the knockout mice being smaller compared to the wild-type mice. So they have much many more smaller fibers compared to wild-type mice at these two time points. So in order for us to figure out what the course of events was, in order to give this phenotype, we did RNA sequencing of the whole time course. And we were particularly interested in the early differentially regulated genes. So the genes that came up differentially different in the two-week time point. And there was 11 genes, and one of them was PPIF. It's coding for cyclophilin D, which is part of the mitochondrial permeability transition pore. It plays an important role to induce pore opening. And you could see that throughout the time course, this expression of PPIF was increased significantly. So cyclophilin D, which is the protein coming from the PPIF gene, is responsive to high intercellular calcium levels. So if calcium levels increase, cyclophilin D is induced. This increases the buffer capacity of the mitochondria. So calcium going into the transport, or not, they're diffusing into the mitochondria, and this leads to, if calcium levels in the cytosol are high, this can lead to dissipation of the membrane potential, matrix swelling, membrane disruption, and also necrosis of the cell. And this occurs in many cell types, not only muscle. We found evidence on the protein level that cyclophilin D is upregulated in the knockout mice, and also other core components of the mitochondrial permeability transition pore. So, to functionally to be able to assess whether there was a functional difference in the ability of mitochondria to respond to high calcium levels, we did an experiment where we isolate the mitochondria from the muscle, and we assessed in a plate reader absorbance of the mitochondria in response to different calcium levels. And high absorption is no swelling, and when absorption lowers, this is an indicator of that the mitochondria are swelling. You see, in the basal state, the mitochondrial volume seems to be larger in the knockout mice, so absorption is lower. And if when we stimulate it with maximal calcium levels, we could see here that the rate of swelling in the knockout mice is higher, significantly higher compared to the wild-type mice. If we induce a maximal calcium concentration, this was not different. So it seems like the mitochondria are more responsive to calcium, and that they and the cyclophilin D plays an important role for this. So because calcium levels are hard to assess in an in vivo model, we turned to a cell model that we generated some years back, in which we stably knocked down NAMPs into 2C12 myoblasts. We could study these cells in response to calcium, but we could also look at just the level of calcium in the cytosol in the basal state, and this was increased in the cells with a knockdown of NAMPs, and we could rescue this effect by providing nicotinamide to the cells. We could also see that calcium in the ER, in the sarcoplasmic reticulum, was decreased, and this corresponds nicely to this increase in the calcium levels in the cytosol. But we could not rescue this with nicotinamide. So it seems like when you perturb the NAMPS pathway, when you reduce NAD levels, this has effect in a muscle cell. In terms of calcium, at least. So there's evidence in the literature that if you genetically or pharmacologically inhibit this cyclophilin D, then you can attenuate muscular dystrophy and also necrosis of muscle fibers. So we hypothesized that by giving cyclosporin A, which is an inhibitor of cyclophilin D, we would inhibit mitochondrial permeability transition pore opening and then rescue the phenotype in these mice. And we just completed a 9-month long study to study the survival of these mice, and we could actually see that knockout mice provided with cyclosporin A in the drinking water lives longer, significantly longer compared to the untreated knockout mice. So in summary, I'm coming to an end now. We show that NAMPT in muscle, lack of NAMPT in muscle leads to premature death. It's very important, crucially important, to maintain NAD levels in muscle. It lowers ATP levels, so energy homeostasis is lowered. And also calcium homeostasis is perturbed. We have increased cyclophilin D, which leads to mitochondrial permeability transition pore opening. This leads to probably muscle dysfunction and muscle dystrophy, and this is the cause of the death, we believe. And we can rescue this effect by providing an inhibitor of cyclophilin D. So my last slide, I just want to turn to humans again. We teamed up with John Wissing and Thomas Krav from University Hospital of Copenhagen, who study muscle dystrophy patients, we wanted to know whether some of the features of our mice could be replicated in humans. So we got samples from Becker muscular dystrophy patients and also hyperkalemic periodic paralysis patients. The BMD patients have mutations in dystrophin gene that leads to muscle weakness. And the hypo-PP patients, they have mutations in the dihydropyridine receptor, which is important for calcium release in muscle. We found no evidence for dysregulation of NAMPT in these patients. NAD levels was actually increased in the hypo-PP patients, and cyclophilin D was not changed. So we're looking more into these patients and working with John and Thomas to see whether there are human models that can resemble what we see in the mice. So with that, I would just thank all the people involved, my group, and I should also mention Marianne, who really started the mice, the work with the mice, and all the collaborators and the funding. And I don't know how I am on time, but I'm finished now at least. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jonas. It was a fantastic talk. I also just want to highlight that you're one of the only persons that I know that works together with both Elysium and ChromaDex, which I think is probably challenging by itself. I know that there are some challenges there at least. So we have a number of questions in Slack. Let me get it up and take a look. So the most upvoted is from David Garcia. He's asking, what do you think of the reported role of NAMPT as an oncogene? Do you see any risk for the chronic use of high dose of NAD precursors?
So that's a good question. Something that we haven't really studied, and I know that there are efforts being made to try to target named inhibitors to tumor cells, and you could think that by providing precursors to the patients, that you would then provide NAD from other pathways that would then make the cancer cells survive even better. Mm. I think I don't think there's any evidence out there in humans, but I think it's important to consider that if you try to inhibit one pathway and you boost another, then you may eliminate some of the effects of the of the inhibition. But,
right.
Yeah.
Very interesting. Definitely something we have to look at, I guess. The second most upvoted is from me, so I'm happy about that. I wrote in a previous comment, and I'm just going to take a little bit on that. Fantastic talk too. Did you investigate PDC1 alpha levels and acetylation of the muscle in NAMPT knockout mice, because we know that sure. NAD can regulate this pathway also?
Yep. Protein levels of PDC1 alpha is very hard to detect, as people know. But PDC1 alpha was not one of the genes that were differentially regulated, as far as I remember, in the knockout mice.
I see.
In the RNA-seq data, at least. So, and we didn't do acetylation, obviously, because you would have to have an antibody specifically either able to Western blot or IP PDC1 alpha, I guess, to do this.
That is challenging. I know that also from my own work. Okay, we have a question from Thomas Hansen. Hi, Jonas. Great talk. Did you see any increase in lysosome content in the skeletal muscle in NAMPT in knockout mice?
Yeah. Thomas Krauf, who's at the University Hospital of Copenhagen, he's very skilled in the histological analyses of these mice, and then he's been doing this for us. I can't recall that he has mentioned anything about lysosomes, but one thing that we do see actually is an induction of autophagy in the in the animals. So it could be that lysosomal volume would be increased as well. But the autophagy pathway is very much in line with the data that we have on AMP kinase as well, AMP kinase induces autophagy in the muscle, and that's also what we see.
I guess that would make sense. So mitophagy, have you looked at that specifically or only just broad autophagy?
It's broadly autophagy we have looked at.
Very interesting. We have one from Wilbert Vermey. Do you expect other interventions such as soluble activin receptor that can extend health span and DNA repair deficient progeroid muscle aging also might be of benefit to your knockout mice?
I didn't get the first.
This is a activin receptor, soluble activin receptor. Are you familiar with that? I'm actually not familiar with that. So if you're familiar with that, you would be very
happy to
be educated about this.
I don't actually know much about that either. So we'll probably have to skip that. Sorry about that.
But if you can go on Slack and then you can write what this is or refer to a paper, we would be very interested in reading about this. I have another question that I posed myself, so I'm going to ask that. Fantastic talk to you. That's what I said before. I'll say it again. Do muscles express CD38, and does this change with exercise or age?
Yep, that's also very good. I mean, we haven't actually looked at it with exercise, which we probably should. It does express CD38, and there are studies with CD38 knockout mice, and the ability to maintain NAD levels is actually, as far as I remember, increased with age. So it's certainly one of the big consumers of NAD in the muscle cell, from what I know.
I mean, we have the CD38 muscle knockout mice, but I couldn't remember exactly. There's, I think, still some debate. Okay. We still have a couple more questions here. We have another one from Wilbert Vermey. Is exercise directly boosting NAD levels, or can this also be influenced via myokines?
Influenced by myokines, it probably can. I don't know. We haven't seen changes in NAD content as such with acute exercise. I think if you exercise train, then you would probably be able to see a higher level. I mean, that it would your ability to maintain NAD levels is actually at least maintained or even increased when we see the named protein levels going up with exercise training. So I would expect that training would increase NAD levels, but I don't think we've seen increase. There are some early studies by Johanovac's group showing that the NAD-NADH ratio increases with exercise, acute exercise in mice. But I don't think we've seen that in our models.
Okay, I see. I'll jump out of the Slack and just ask a question about the clinical in our work, which I think is very interesting, where you have, in some ways played the devil because haven't seen much effect in some of the stuff that you looked at. What do you think? Do you think, is there an importance of NR in aging or in metabolic diseases? And what do you think the future is? Are we at the wrong dose, or what's the future?
No, I think it's from my data in the mice, you can just see, you can really say that it's extraordinary that some animals actually live with a reduction of 90% of the NAD in the muscle, so there's a huge redundancy. So it may not matter so much if we just boost NAD levels by 10%. But I think what we've been looking at is probably the wrong populations. And there are some evidence now, there was a cell metabolism paper from a Finnish group showing that nicotinic acid could actually, in mitochondrial dystrophic patients, was beneficial for muscle function, for instance. So I think there is evidence that the precursors of NAD can be beneficial for metabolic health. But I think it's you have to be either sick or maybe very, very old.
I see, to get the benefit. So I'm taking NR semi-regularly, so I guess maybe I don't need to do that until I get a little bit older.
Maybe if you do it, when in combination with exercise, for instance.
That could be
something that.
Yeah. So is this something you might study also?
That was we in the first study we did. We actually considered whether we should have an exercise arm to the clinical trial as well, but it was just too much work for the poor PhD student though.
I see. Yeah,
I was doing the study, so we couldn't really do that. But right. Something that we have been considering. Certainly.
That's great. So if anybody's out there who wants to do that study, that would be great. All right, let's thank Jonas again.